So, we were talking about dreaming last week and the uses of dreams and how dreams can be used to help spiritual polarization, meaning giving us clues as to energy center blockages, whether the person basically is or is not positively polarized, meaning for those who have not yet made a choice, dreams can help give them a clue as to a deeper meaning in their life and the orientation that they need. For somebody who's positively oriented already and generally working from heart center and up, although they may still have blockages, if there's significant baffling or blocking of energies, meaning some problem in their mind, in their life, in their mind, that's quite important or significant at the current time, the dream could show it to them and help them resolve it by giving a clue as to the nature of the blockage. Then there's the dream that's related to precognition, and then there's the dream which is really an adept's out-of-body training, which is not a dream at all, but a use of nighttime action to increase learning in service to the all, or the positive adept. So we can't get into all of that before, from last week. The main section is page 38. So today we'll start with page 39, additional uses of dreaming, and perhaps we'll get into the section called From Desire to Enlightenment. So let me start. So Don asks, Ra, are there other functions of dreaming of value in the evolutionary process? And Ra says, although there are many which are of some value, we would choose two to note, since these two, though not of value in polarization, may be of value in a more generalized sense. So dreams that are of value for our soul evolution. Number one. The activity of dreaming is an activity in which there is made a finely wrought and excellently fashioned bridge from conscious to unconscious. In this state, the various distortions which have occurred in the energy web of the body complex due to the misprision with which energy influxes have been received are healed. With the proper amount of dreaming comes the healing of these distortions. Continued lack of this possibility can seriously distort or can cause serious distortion in the mind-body-spirit system. And I will review that in a moment. Number two, the other function of dreaming which is of aid is that type of dream which is visionary, and which prophets and mystics have experienced from days of old. Their visions come through the roots of mind and speak to a hungry world. Thus, this type of dream is of service without being of a personally polarizing nature. However, in that mystic or prophet who desires to serve, such service will increase the entity's polarity. So, some really important points here. The first is a further description of what a dream is. A dream is a bridge, finely created bridge, delicately, carefully created bridge from unconscious to conscious, between the conscious mind and the deep mind. In the state of dreaming, there is healing. And so Ra say the various distortions which have occurred in the energy web of the body complex. So they're talking about chakra center blockages, energy center blockages. These are distortions in the energy web of body. The cause is, Ra says, misprision. Strange word. You know, your word is precision, This is misprision, means sort of a misfitting. Due to the misprision with which the energy influxes have been received. This is happening at the planetary level too, and that was the reason for the major pyramid building around the world of days gone by, was the misprision of the planet receiving energy from cosmic sources. Likewise, the not fitting or incompatibility or non-congruent, you know, imperfect joining or reception of energy into the physical body of a human, of an individual, from, you know, the planetary energy field and others and higher self, that's a cause of distortion or blockage in the centers, right? We're not receiving it well. And it's, you know, similar to like we talked about meditation on physical pain. But I think they're often cause further distortion or blockage. And I was contrasting that with the Burmese Buddhist group approach, a particular group in Burma, where they basically focus on their pain, physical sensation. And they sit there quietly in deep pain until it disappears, which it does. And that's becoming fully receptive to the catalyst of pain. It's not easy and it's not pleasant. But that is well receiving the catalyst of that experience, rather than distorting it further by ways of killing it and pushing it away. So the point about dreams is that the energy center blockages caused by non-love, by non-acceptance, non-receiving, poor receiving, those blockages are healed by sleep, by dream, period. Dreams heal blockages. It's very, very interesting. So, you know, in Greece or Mediterranean, Middle East, there were dream temples, healing temples of the gods associated with sleep. And it's, I don't know if they really worked or if they had any inkling of this, but it's the same idea, that dreams heal energy chakra blockages. With the proper amount of dreaming comes the healing of these distortions. And of course, continued lack of, you know, REM sleep, continued lack of sleep and dreaming can cause serious distortion in the person. The other function of dreams, which Ross says, is not itself polarizing, meaning it doesn't itself unblock chakras, but if it's used to help others, it is helping the person polarize. That type of dream is called a vision, like the prophets, Old Testament. Hi, Renee. Glad you're with us. We're on page 40, talking about visionary dreams that are don't necessarily lead to unblocking or spiritual growth of the prophet or the dreamer, but when they serve through those, through speaking their vision of the future to their community, that helps them grow spiritually. So that's the other type of dream, which is similar to the personal dream of a predictive type, in terms of, you know, dreaming that, somebody's going to die soon, or I'm going to die soon, or the future is going to be something for my family soon. That's sort of personally predictive. Rob talked about that before. Then there's collective prediction, which is a visionary dream. So Don asks, is the REM state the portion of sleep in which there's dreaming? Rob says, yes, it's correct. Don asks, there seems to be small units during the night with gaps in between in sleep. Why? This is sort of, you know, the idea that you you go back to sleep and you have some period of dreaming. It seems like some period with no dreaming and different phases or stages in the whole night process. Ra gives a complicated answer. Ra says, the portions of the dreaming process which are helpful for polarization, meaning unblocking chakras, and also for the vision of the mystic, which is the visionary type, take place in time-space, which is non-physical. Consequently, it uses the bridge from the metaphysical to physical for what seems to be a brief period of your time. However, the equivalent amount of experience in time-space is far greater. This is the old experience of many, many out-of-body journeyers, that they had this epic journey in another planet, another dimension, a whole landscape situation, a whole saga. And then they come back and look at their clock and 3 minutes passed. So this is that the amount of experience in time-space is substantially greater than the elapsed time in space-time, meaning the elapsed clock time in the physical world is much less than the breadth, you know, the expanse of the experience at the same moment, at the same point in time-space, out of body. Same thing with the dreams. So the bridge is the transition, and I think it probably doesn't need a lot of 3D time, physical time, and that's why it seems that things start and stop, or units of experience in the dreaming sequence overnight. Ra goes on, the bridge remains, however, and traduces each distortion of mind, body, and spirit, and works upon the various distortions of energy influxes so that healing may take place. This healing process does not occur with the incidence of rapid eye movement, but rather occurs largely in the space-time portion of the mind-body-spirit, and uses the bridge time-space for the process of healing to be enabled. Okay. What is that all about? Well, you know, this is why many people don't read Ra, because it's kind of difficult. They're saying that, number one, the portions of dreaming which are involved in energy chakra balancing or unblocking are occurring in time-space, in the non-physical 3D, 3D non-physical. And so that means that, you know, it's happening in the deep mind on the other side of the veil. And that activity uses a bridge or bridges to the physical brain for what seems to us to be a small period of time. What's happening in the deep mind or on the other side of the veil, in terms of the transformation, of course, is a much larger amount of time. That bridge or that connection from unconscious to conscious remains. And it actually is like a sweep. It's like a sweeping bridge or an energy sweeping process. This notion of traduces. I didn't look it up recently, and it's not a word I use too often, but I believe traduces is about sort of covering and sensing the contours of, being in close relation to the contours of something. Just a moment. So this bridge is basically an energy link from deep mind to conscious mind, from time-space to the physical body. It's occurring, you know, within what we would say within the body, but it's the energy fields that are around the physical and within the physical, some portion of that represents time-space, or is connected to what Rob calls time-space. So that bridge is like an energy sweeping, or it touches the contours of the distortions of mind-body-spirit. It works upon these distortions, these energy distortions. You see, distortions of mind are distortions of energy influx. It's the same. And the chakras themselves are really energy receivers and transmitters. So by that bridge of dreaming, and by that bridge through which we remember dreams, meaning the bridge and the dreaming are not quite the same. You can say that the dreaming is a bridge. You can say that the dreaming uses a bridge. But in any case, there's a bridge and there's dreaming. And that's an energy linkage, basically. It's just an energy linkage. That also, by the way, does happen to some extent in meditation, in deep meditation, in which there's an expansion of consciousness beyond the body identification, and the etheric body expands beyond the normal tight attachment to the physical. The energy body expands a bit. When that happens, there is a healing. There is some degree of healing that just happens from sitting in meditation without asking for healing. It's not about affirmation. It's not about using the intellect. It's about putting yourself in a position of pure centered receptivity, receptivity to whatever occurs, body, mind, spirit, watching the breath or watching the process. There is a kind of allowing of untanglements to or tanglements to untangle naturally, the tangle energy chakra blockage and tangles to become naturally smooth and untangled. That actually happens. That's why doing meditation is usually people have better health from it. So Ross says healing is not the same as rapid eye movement. The rapid eye movement doesn't mean the healing of the chakras is happening, but it is related to the dreaming. So they're a little, these things are kind of related, but they're not quite the same. But I think what they're saying is that this healing occurs in the physical part, and then, actually, it's interesting. Their language is kind of not clear. When they say this healing uses the bridge, this healing occurs in space-time and uses the bridge time-space for the process to be enabled, is saying that the healing occurs in space-time, in the physical. And it's supported by the bridge, or, you know, the bridging of deep mind and conscious mind, unconscious, conscious, time-space, space-time, non-physical to physical. That bridging allows the healing in the physical to happen. And that bridging or linking or energy sweep coordination between the inner self and the outer self, really, allows healing of energy chakra blockages. And so you can dream and sleep your way to healing, actually. And so that's why people in certain mental states, you know, want to just go into bed, pull up the covers. And we all feel that sometimes. That's healing. It's not running away, it's running into. So it's interesting. Dream is, you know, kind of a gift from the gods, the old folks said. It's basically part of the homeostatic equilibrium, self-healing function, collection of functions of body, mind, spirit complex, you know. It's part of the plan that we have that function that allows us to heal distortions in mind and blockages in the energy centers by what we do, what we need every single night. So there's some benefit to dreaming and sleeping regardless, whether you remember or not. And if you remember, I would just say that it would help speed along the process of understanding what the dreams are saying. The dreams are working on the healing, whether we know what they're saying or not. But if we know, if we want to know what they're saying or what work is being done, and we want to lend a hand, then it helps to remember the dreams, for sure. Mm-hmm. So that's what I would say, that, you know, the doctor is working, whether you are conscious or unconscious. But if you want to help the doctor, sure, he can accept some help, and that'll help the operation. The position of the bed in the room is important. The position of the bed in relation to windows and north-south is important. The quality of your bed is important. And the silence or non-silence of the location is important. So, you know, we are an electromagnetic field. And there's such a thing as a Faraday cage. You know about that, Erhard, which screens out all different kinds of electromagnetic fields or forces or radiation. And psychics do better in Faraday cages. And people can actually have certain experiences there because normal electromagnetic influences don't penetrate. Likewise, in sleep, the nature of the dreaming and the quality of restfulness of the sleep itself, very much related to the electromagnetics. You know, that's why people like to go on vacation. They get away from their normal electromagnetic fields and sleep better, you know, by the beach, by the waterfall. So, I mean, that type of vacation. So anyway, thing, you know, that Ra was commenting on the amount of time-space experience that can happen that is associated with a dream that may seem quite long is, in physical terms, quite short. This is not unrelated to the current experience of time speeding up. Time is not speeding up. You know, I don't really know what time is. Some new physicists talk about time as an energy continuum. I prefer to see time as a function of consciousness, meaning the greater the development or expansion of consciousness, the more unitary or all-encompassing is the experience of time, meaning higher self doesn't experience past, present, future. It's all now, right? Be here now. The all now, the all present, the all this moment is an experience of time or timelessness associated with sixth density. Now Earth is moving into fourth density. And so our experience is basically blended a little bit between the 3D brain and a 4D pulling of, or the quality of fourth density, heart chakra, fourth dimension energetics in the planet, of the planet, associated with our mind. In some way, our experience now is closer to a fourth density experience than it's ever been before, of course, right? The planet is right on the cusp of the 4D transition. So more can happen in a shorter space of time. And that's one way of saying time is speeding up. Or my experience of time is that it feels it is speeding up. More meaning, it happens faster. Now, is more happening in a shorter amount of time, like the bridging of time-space to space-time and dreaming, right? more is happening, the big dreams are happening in time-space, but little time is passing in physical world? Yeah. There's also an experience of the smoothing of catalyst, that there's less friction. So it's like time flies when you're having fun. Well, maybe you can say we're all having more fun. Or, you know, 4Ds have more fun. Like blondes have more fun, I used to say in the 60s. Silly people. So blondes have more fun. 4Ds, 4D souls have more fun. Or there's less friction in fourth density, so time goes faster. Or the experience of time is smoother, so that it seems to pass faster. And that's the notion of 4D lifespan being, you know, 90,000 years, Ross said. In developed fourth density, the lifespan is 90,000. So put that next to Billy Meyer's Pleiadians, who have a lifespan of 1,000 or so. They're at the beginning of 4D. So, you know, 4D is a big long journey itself. And in some way, because there's some blended experience now for us of a 3D, 4D continuum, it is a little more dreamlike, a little bit more time-space-like, a little bit more sense of unreality or magical quality of life, of reality. So let's go on. This is a very nice section here. So this is the bottom of page 40, the section called From Desire to Enlightenment. Very interesting. Don asks, does a person need to destroy the self and ignore the material world in order to reach enlightenment? What is the proper role of the individual self and its worldly activities to aid them in growing more into the law of one? So, you know, it's kind of funny to see somebody asking, do you need to destroy yourself to reach enlightenment? This is, you know, kind of a confused Western notion of what the Easterners are doing. Ra says, the proper role of the entity in third density is to experience all things desired, and then to analyze, understand, and accept these experiences, distilling from them the love light within them. Nothing shall be overcome. Nothing shall be overcome. That which is not needed falls away. Hear, hear. Spiritual orientation then develops due to the analysis of one's desires. These desires eventually become more and more in harmony with making conscious use of love light. As the soul furnishes itself with distilled experience, we have found it to be extremely inappropriate to encourage a person to overcome any desires. The only exception is for those desires that infringe on the free will of others, harming others, in which case we suggest that you use your imagination rather than try to carry them out in the physical plane. The reason that it is unwise, meaning no wisdom, fifth chakra blockage, the reason that it is unwise to try to overcome your desires is because the act of overcoming is an unbalanced action, creating difficulties in energy balancing over a period of time. Trying to overcome desires actually creates the conditions of mind that lead to further holding on to that which you think you are overcoming, but which is actually only buried in the unconscious. All things are acceptable in the proper time for each entity. And in experiencing, in understanding, in accepting, in then sharing with others, you will be able to move away from distortions of one kind to less distorted conditions of mind, body, spirit, which are more in harmony with the law of one. It is a shortcut to simply ignore or overcome any desire, but it does not work beyond one lifetime, says me. Instead, the desire needs to be understood and accepted. This takes patience and experience, which can be analyzed with care, with compassion for self and others. Now, that's very important. Ra is not a moralist. Ra is not a dogmatist. Ra is not saying, stuff it, man. Just stop it. Not at all. Ra is saying, go for it. Now, however, in a certain way, the proper role of the entity in third density is to experience all things desired. That's very permission-giving to us guilt-ridden, delusion-conditioned, religion-tainted humans. You know? These human religions are pretty sick, folks. Not all of them. Not all aspects. But they're pretty self-denying. You know? Humanity is a throttled race. We're here with the throttled. So, the proper role of the proper role, not even work, the role, that's what a 3D entity does. A 3D entity is the entity who experiences all things they want based on their selfish desire. Whatever level it comes from. And then, however, to analyze, understand, and accept these experiences and these desires, distilling from them the love light within them. Nothing shall be overcome, because that which is not needed falls away. Now, of course, it may take 10 lifetimes to fall away. So, you know, the Buddhist teacher, the Hindu teacher, all the real teachers, who may be Western teachers too, of course, the real teachers, you know, they really don't want to say, sure, man, take 10 lifetimes, you know. They're really saying, you know, you get with it now. And so that's why that teaching, their teaching, can be heavy-handed and repressive or control, what seems to be too tight. You know, the Buddhist teaching, right? I mean, if you are a monk, you have no sex. You have no contact with the opposite gender in the traditional way. You don't even touch them. They're not even the same. You know, they have to be separated by a person, by another person in between. When I was a monk for a short time last year in a Thai temple in the U.S., there was a Chinese woman who was eager to help me, and she was sitting on a chair next to mine. And the older Thai monk looked at me and he said, "Too close." So she booped away and kneeled on the floor. So, you know, okay, that's a little different than what Ra's saying. But Ra's saying, you know, hey, in the life of higher self and soul, 10 lifetimes being stuck in some desire is okay. But they're really not asking you to get stuck. What they're saying is overcoming doesn't work. Repression, suppression, I hate this, I don't want this, this is bad, I don't want this desire, I don't even want to look at it, I don't even want to know it, that doesn't work. What they're saying is experience what you desire. And also, analyze and understand and accept those desires and the experiences, you know, meaning, are you really happy? Does it really get you something you want? Was it really worth it? You know, you got it. Now what? So, they also say, of course, desires that infringe on the free will of others should be kept in your imagination, not to speak, not to act. You can speak to your friend or yourself or whatever, but don't hurt anybody. Don't hurt anybody. So do it in your head. But don't repress it. And what they're saying is this is the big view. This is what higher self thinks. Spiritual orientation develops due to analysis of one's desires. Was it worth it? Do I really want this? You know, is this really my right way? And over time, desires eventually become more and more in harmony with making conscious use of love light. As we polarize and give ourselves distilled experience, means experience that we're creating consciously. I choose this. I choose these desires rather than those desires, because I found by my analysis of the experience that these desires are truly more fulfilling than those desires. But that's not overcoming. That's not repression. That's just conscious choice from analysis of desire after having allowed ourselves to experience it. So we found it extremely inappropriate to encourage a person to overcome the desires. The reason that it's unwise to overcome your desires is because overcoming itself is an unbalanced action, creating difficulties in energy balancing over a period of time. When I was in college, I met a guy who believes that he did the charnel ground decomposing body meditations of Buddhism in a past life, meaning he meditated on decomposing bodies in a charnel ground with vultures eating flesh in a past life. He's a nice guy, but his sexuality was totally bent, meaning like stuck or stopped or just, you know, like hammered down, meaning he and his partner didn't have it. And there was something he talked about, I don't remember actually, but he had a very uncomfortable view of body and sexuality. Of course, if you meditate on decomposing bodies for too long, it can happen. That's a Buddhist meditation, to develop aversion to body and sexuality. And that definitely can create trouble. So, where else are you going to hear this kind of information? So the reason it's unwise is because this overcoming is unbalanced, because it isn't loving, you know? It creates difficulties in energy balancing in future lives. That's what they mean by over a period of time. Trying to overcome desires creates the conditions of mind that lead to further holding on to that which you think you are overcoming. I hate it. I hate it. I hate it. I hate it. And so I never leave it, because I'm so busy hating it. I'm so busy pushing it down that I can't take my foot off of it. And that's a further holding on to that which I think I'm overcoming. And here's the point. All things are acceptable in the proper time for each entity. So that's a very heavy, you know. That is why great masters don't judge or blame anybody. They know better. They've seen that guy before in the past, and they can see his future lives too. And even if he goes to hell or becomes a demon or whatever it is, yeah, it's his choice. And it's acceptable at a certain point. And so, you know, the people who wave the flag and, you know, go to hot rod shows and eat hot dogs and, you know, cheer on the football team or the police, you know, wrestling club. You know, that's proper for them then. So what? And the Illuminati and the negatives and their mice and foxes and chickens and the whole bunch of them, they like it. They do it. It's right for them. They think that they're good by doing that. So it's proper. But the point is that experiencing and understanding and accepting the results of our desires, the experiences of allowing our desire, and then sharing with others what we've learned, allows us to move from distortions of one kind to less distorted conditions, meaning distortions of another kind. And then we're more in harmony with the law of one. So that's a natural process if the person allows themselves to understand the fruit of their desiring and the experience of that. If the person doesn't introspect, then they definitely can go round and round for many, many lifetimes, as the humans here do, recycling in 3D, without polarizing. But there is growth. There is growth. Definitely. And so anyway, finally, it's a shortcut to simply ignore or overcome any desire, and it doesn't work beyond the one lifetime. That's for sure. I've seen that with a lot of people and myself, meaning I can see what they used to do and now where they are. They're still stuck. The desire needs to be understood and accepted. It takes patience and experience that can be analyzed with care, compassion for yourself and others. So that's all we're going to do in terms of raw text for today. Any questions about this? This is very important, you know. If some psychologists talk about it. Religionists normally don't. New Age people sometimes do, but they have a lot of repression themselves or overcoming. So next week we will start on page 41. This is a section working with the unmanifest self. And this is kind of heavy. What is the unmanifest being? It's not quite the same as the higher self. It's sort of the time-space soul versus the physical personality. And then we'll get on to balancing wisdom and compassion. Very nice. This is the root of the fourth, fifth chakra work, the balancing of love, wisdom. And maybe we'll get into time, space, and enlightenment. These are, you know, this is real spiritual philosophy here. And I just want to say, I think that, you know, it's a challenge to not try to push down certain desires when we've been taught and everyone around us ultimately is quite self-controlled. We've been taught self-restraint. And Ra is not saying, you know, go around and be a sociopath. Course. A lot of people, you know, are afraid to live in a society without policemen and law. You know, where everybody takes care of each other or everybody doesn't want to hurt. You know, everybody knows that harming is not good for me, that harming anyone or anything is bad for me, then nobody harms anybody. Then you don't need laws and police and government, or at least the form it is now. Of course. And that's the basis of higher dimensional groups, of course. Everybody's positive. Nobody wants to hurt anybody. Everybody wants the same thing. Everybody wants love, light, growth, benefit to all. So, but working with desires is a challenge because we don't really know what they are. Lots of people don't know what they want. What do you really want? We want a lot or we don't want a lot. We may want a lot and not know it. We may not really want a lot, but also not quite have that life. So it's really important to know what I want, you know, meaning what you want. So I recommend that kind of reflection. What really brings fulfillment? So there are different perspectives on that, but it's useful just to reflect that, you know, Ra saying that the proper role for the entity in third density is to experience all things desired. Nothing shall be overcome. That which is not needed falls away. And that's really trusting in the big picture and trusting in our basic goodness. What we are is what we really need. And allowing ourselves to go through the phases of immature desire is fine, because everything is, you know, all things are acceptable in the proper time for each entity. So the proper time now is that we need to end. And thank you for being here. I appreciate my role. I've grew very, very much. And so I appreciate everybody being here, keeping it going. So next week we'll continue working with the unmanifest self, balancing wisdom and compassion, and something about time, space, and enlightenment. So please be well, and I look forward to talking with you again next week. Take care. Good night.